is going to be 10 nations. That's what Daniel chapter 7 says. Look at chapter 7, verse 23. It says, the fourth beast, my eyes are going crazy, will be a fourth kingdom on the earth, different from all the other kingdoms. It will devour the whole earth. It will trample it down and crush it. The 10 horns are 10 kings who will rise from this kingdom. So the Bible kind of tells us that, you know, these 10 toes represent 10 nations. And Daniel tells us it's 10 kings. So the question is, on all of our hearts and minds, when is that kingdom going to come? Well, the Bible answers that. We don't have to wonder about that. Daniel's dream has come true. In my estimation, 95% of it. Nebuchadnezzar's dream has come true, 95%. Here's the last 5%. Look, beginning in verse 44. In the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed. And this kingdom will not be left to another people. It will crush all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it will endure forever. So if you're here today and you're trying to, you know, figure all this out, what's happening? The Bible says that most of the dream has been completed, but the last empire will occur when Jesus comes back to this earth. Now, 2 weeks from now, we're going to be talking about a subject of what we call the rapture, for those of us who go to church. That is what some of us and many of us believe, that is the church will not be here in the last 7 years on this earth because of what's going to happen. But for those who remain behind, a lot's going to occur, and we're going to talk about that in this series. But understand this, none of that will occur, all of that has to occur, until Jesus comes back. So there has to come a point when there are 10 nations that come together. In our video screen, we talked about the ARA, or the African Republic Alliance, and that was kind of like a fictional story of what, you know, could happen. Let me tell you something, folks. It's already happened. And it began back in 1948 when Israel became a nation, but in 1951, there were a group of people who got together over in Europe and said, you know what? We need to be something like the United States of America. Wouldn't it be great if we could come up with the United States of Europe? That was in their mind. And so they began to think ahead, you know, what could we do? And in 1957, you're not going to believe this. Folks, I didn't even know this treaty existed until I did this study on this series. Listen to this. March 28, 1957, there was a treaty that was signed, and you will not believe what the name of this treaty was. The Treaties of Rome. The old Roman Empire, back in 1957, decided, you know, it's time to start rebuilding. And ever since 1957, there have been nations that have been coming into what we now call the European Union. That's what it's called. Now, the Bible talks about 10 nations. Right now, in 2009, there are 27 nations involved in the European nation. And all of us are trying to figure out, you know, well, which 10 will it be? Folks, listen, we don't have a clue at this point. And for the most part, if what we believe is right and we're not here, it's not going to matter which 10 it is, okay? We're not going to be around to see it anyway. But there will be 10 nations out of these 27 nations that one day will be the 10 toes that will be, you know, those 10 horns that the Bible talks about. And so all of us today are trying, you know, to figure out, you know, how is this going to happen? Well, the European Union today, listen to this. They now have over 600 million people a part of their union. That's almost twice the size of the population of the United States of America. You say, well, why is that so important? Because of the power and the wealth that they one day will possess. Something happened in 2002 that probably, you know, most of us weren't paying very much attention to, but there were 80 billion coins that were produced in 2002. It is the monetary piece today that we call the euro. And if you ever really want to find out really what's going on today in our economics today, folks, let me tell you something. That euro will probably be the currency of the one world government. You say, well, if that's true, then what's going to happen to the U.S. dollar? That is a very good question. You're going to have to come back in about 4 weeks when we have our next Wednesday night thing, because that's when we're going to talk about America. It really raises a lot of questions. If that's true, if the euro eventually replaces the U.S. dollar, what does that mean? Or if the U.S. dollar falls in such value that the euro happens to be the one world currency, what does that say about where the power and the strength and the wealth will be, and what does that say about even America? So today, you know, when we look at this, the Roman Empire really is in the process of being rebuilt. There's one big piece missing at this point. Because under the old Roman Empire, Israel was under Rome. And today they're not. Today the Roman Union or the European Union, they use the euro as their monetary cash flow means of transferring wealth. They will not let Israel be a part of that union. You know why? Because they say that they have caused acts of inhumanity when they have bombed people, like what's going on even today in Gaza. They're saying because of what Israel has done to what many of us believe to be just protecting themselves, but because of what they've done, the European Union says, you can't be a part of this group. So let me ask you a question. How would it ever occur that they would ever let Israel into that union? The Bible tells us. The Bible tells us, folks, listen to me very carefully. One day there will be a peace treaty signed between Israel and the Palestinians. That's how close we are. That's how close we are. Now, you know, we've got a brand new president coming into office this week, and we need to be praying for him. We need to support him, and I hope all of us want him to succeed, because if he does, then we do. But listen to me very carefully, folks. When we look at where our president-elect has come from and all that he's brought with him, man, he has tremendous abilities. And you start thinking about how all these pieces could start flowing together. What if God decided to let him or use him to help start building the foundation, if you will, for that peace treaty that every other president that I can remember has tried to establish? What if President Obama is able to do that? And Israel and the Palestinians have what will be just a temporary peace treaty. You need to know that. It's not going to last. But it will last for about 3.5 years. And all of a sudden, Israel is now accepted into the European Union. And now we have the complete Roman Empire revived. That's how close we are. Now, if you believe in the rapture, then you probably know that we're not here for that. Folks, listen to me. When you hear them start talking about signing a peace treaty in the Middle East, you better have your bags packed. You better have your bags packed. That's how close we are. So when we look at this today, you know, how do we make a distinction here? Well, I think we need to understand there's a distinction between our personal dreams and God's providential dreams. I think it's okay for us to have personal dreams as long as they line up with God's priorities and his word in our lives. In fact, if I was to sit down with most of you, I think you have some of the same dreams that I have. I mean, dreams for our family and dreams about our finances and dreams about, you know, our church and all the things that we think about. Nothing wrong with having those kind of dreams. After all, some of them do come true.